So our case today is Mr. Mike Ashley, let's say, and he is 29 years old, presented with palpitation. Okay, you have a 2 minute, then we're gonna start the case, okay?
I'm sorry, Dr. Ali, I didn't catch it. Is it gonna be station 5 or 2?
Station 5.
Okay.
Okay, Mr. Mike Ashley. Station 5, 29 years old, presented with palpitation. Okay, you have a 2 minute, then we're gonna start the case. Just I would like to confirm that we're gonna practice this case in just instead of 10 minutes, I'm going to discuss the whole case with him in a 9 minute. 5 minute, he will do the history and he can go to examination. Then I'm going to notify him about the 2 minutes that remain. After the 7 minute finished, I'm going to discuss the case with him in additional 2 minutes. Okay, so the total is 9 minutes instead of 10 minutes. Okay, Dr. Hassan, let's start. Are you ready?
Yes, Dr. Ali.
Okay, so 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Hi, I'm Dr. Hassan, one of the doctors in the medical admission unit. May I confirm that you're Mr. Mike, 29 years old?
Yes, doctor.
Mr. Mike, I've been asked to examine you and have a chat with you regarding your medical condition. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine with me, doctor.
I got a letter from your GP stating that you are complaining of some awareness of your heartbeats. Could you please tell me more about this?
Well, doctor, I noted that over the last 3 months, I start to develop this, how can I describe it? But I feel like my heart is keep pumping in a fast way, doctor. I don't know what's wrong with me. I never encountered such an issue before.
I'm really sorry for that, Mr. Mike. Be sure that we are here to help you. And could you please tell me if it is an irregular or irregular pattern? It's like this, or?
I think it's like irregular, doctor.
Okay. And it's your first time to have this?
Yeah, it's my first time to have such an issue, doctor. But it's keep coming and going now for 3 months, doctor.
Any specific time of day?
No, doctor. I don't think so.
Do you think it's related to any effort or exercise?
Yes, doctor. I noticed sometimes it's happened after I do some exercises, especially after the early morning jogging, doctor.
Okay. Any other symptoms, doctor? Mr. Mike, with this, like any blackout or any dizziness?
No, doctor.
Okay. What did you think that they're gonna relieve it? It's like rest or something?
Well, actually sometimes it happened while I'm resting, doctor. I'm not doing anything, but I'm not doing anything specifically to relieve it, doctor. So sometimes it's just gone away by itself.
Okay. Any heart problems before, Mr. Mike? Any chest pain?
No, doctor.
Any shorts of breathing?
No, doctor. Ever encounter such an issue?
Any ankle swelling?
No, doctor. Never.
Okay. Any leg swelling, Mr. Mike, or leg pain?
Leg pain. No, doctor.
Okay. And can I ask you if you have any past medical history, any chronic illness?
Yes, doctor. I have an asthma, I think now for 10 years, doctor.
And it's well controlled, Mike, or no?
Well, I'm using just this salbutamol inhaler from time to time, doctor, occasionally when I have this shortness of breath. But it has been a while now since I used my inhaler.
Okay. Any other medical conditions?
No, doctor.
Okay. And did you notice while you have this fast heartbeats, any sweating?
Yes, doctor. I noted the sweating.
Any hand shaking, was it?
No, doctor.
Okay. And any other medications are you on?
No, doctor. Aside from sometimes just a paracetamol for sometime, I have just a headache, but that's fine. Nothing else.
Okay. Okay. Any weight change recently?
No, doctor.
Any weather preference?
I don't know. What do you mean by weather preference? But no, doctor.
Do you prefer hot weather or cold weather?
No, doctor. I don't think I have such an issue.
Any fever or increase in body temperature?
No, doctor.
Any lumps or bumps?
No, doctor.
Any headache? Any visual problems?
Well, I have a headache, doctor, from time to time, but I believe it is something just related to my excessive work of hours, doctor. Hours of working, sorry, doctor. I'm a sales representative. I want to achieve my yearly target. So sometimes I stay in front of the computer screen or laptop screen for a long hours. So I just assume it's because of that. And 2 minutes remain, doctor.
Can I examine you, Mr. Mike, while we keep talking? I want to examine the pulse. It's regular and...
Okay, it's regular.
Okay. And can I see if there is any tremors in the hand?
No tremors.
Okay. Can I examine his neck for any neck mass or any thyroid?
There is a neck swelling.
Okay. And can I ask for an inspection while drinking some water, sips of water?
Yes, there is an obvious neck swelling, thyroid swelling.
Any eye exophthalmos or proptosis?
No.
Okay, can I do the visual movement?
Yes, you can, doctor.
Okay, H movement for the eyes.
It's normal.
Okay, and lid leg.
It's normal.
Okay. And can I examine his heart? Can I listen to his heart? Any murmurs?
Okay, you can go. Examine the heart.
The mitral, the apex. Okay. Mr. Mike, what do you do for a living?
I'm a sales representative, doctor.
Any stress in your life?
Yes, doctor. Yes, we are. I'm finding very difficult to achieve my sales target. So yeah.
Do you smoke, Mr. Mike?
Yeah, I smoke from time to time, doctor.
Okay, so we can ask the occupational health and social workers to be involved to help you in this regard. Any concern, Mr. Mike?
What's wrong with me, doctor? Why I have those palpitations? Is it because of my work? Is it because of the stress?
I appreciate your concern, Mr. Mike. I think it could be, but we first we do we need to do more blood tests and imaging, and involve a group of specialists to find the and to confirm the diagnosis, give you the management plan. There is many causes for that. It could be a problem in your neck gland, or it could be just the stress. May I ask, your consumption of caffeine has been increased or something?
Yes, it increased recently, doctor. Yeah, I'm trying to maintain my focus and concentration. This is why I assume that I'm drinking a lot of coffee recently. Thank you, doctor. Your time is finished. Examiner question.
Okay.
What's your finding, physical finding in this case?
So I believe the positive finding was a neck swelling, neck mass, most probably thyroid.
Okay. So what's your differential and what's your diagnosis for this case?
So it could be a wide differential, like it could be an anxiety related or stress related palpitation. It could be a sign of hyperthyroidism. Or it could be
so your list of differential, either it could be anxiety related or it could be because of the hyperthyroidism. Any other differential?
I think no.
Okay, how you are going to investigate this patient?
First of all, a basic investigation, blood test like CBC, searching for anemia, and liver function test, kidney function test for any abnormalities, electrolytes for any derangements can cause arrhythmias or palpitations, ECG bedside ECG to make sure that it's a regular sinus tachycardia or not, thyroid function test. T4, T3, TSH, and thyroid antibodies, TPO, and TSH, thyroid immunoglobulins. And
okay, how you are going to how you are going to treat this gentleman?
So basically, it will be depending on the underlying cause. First of all, education and counseling about the smoking and caffeine intake, and if he will need stress management in his work and life. Second, pharmacological, depending on the underlying cause, if it is a thyroid, hyperthyroidism.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hassan. I think the time is finished. Okay.
Thank you.
Let's start from the beginning. What do you think you missed in the history? What are the important aspects of the history you didn't ask or inquire about at all in this history? What do you think? Did you forget?
I couldn't have family history, of course.
Okay, if you ask me about the family history and I told you that my mother has, or let's say my father has some sort of kidney disorder, or he has some sort of a cancer before in his neck, what do you say? What your diagnosis will be?
You mean Men syndrome, or?
Yeah, it could be Men type too. Okay. What else in the history you forget?
The social history in details and the sexual history.
What else? Did you ask about the past medical history, past surgical history? If I told you I had some sort of surgery when I was 1 month old, and my mother told me that I had some sort of bowel surgery or abdominal surgery, or let's say GI surgery, or I have some surgery in my tummy, what you will think the diagnosis will be?
So it could be a part of from a congenital abnormalities, and it could
okay,
be...
Okay, I'm going to answer this question later on, it's fine. Okay, if I told you, did you ask me about the bowel motion?
No, I didn't. I didn't do a systemic review in details, yeah.
Okay, if I told you I have a constipation and I have an abdominal pain, what it could be? Something within the man. What gland that can be affected and lead to abdominal pain and
you mean phaeochromocytoma?
Sorry?
Phaeochromocytoma, I mean. Sorry, hypercalcemia.
Hypercalcemia from the hyperparathyroidism.
Hyperparathyroidism, yeah.
Okay, that's good. Okay. In the differential, I told you that I'm using salbutamol inhaler. Could it be a reason for the
palpitation? I have excluded it before because of the long-term controlled asthma without any inhalers.
Okay, so now what can explain the palpitation? I told I filled the gap in your history, and I told you that I have a history of family. My father has some sort of cancer in his neck. Most probably it's a thyroid cancer. I told you I have a constipation. And I told you I have abdominal pain, most probably from the renal stone due to the hypercalcemia. So what could explain the palpitation at the end?
You mean the phaeochromocytoma?
It's a phaeochromocytoma, part of men type 2. It's most probably the reason behind the current palpitation. I'm right?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. Okay, if the case was phaeochromocytoma, what else are you going to ask about?
The other manifestations of men type 2 A or B. And I will ask about the blood pressure, of course, and if any association with any skin rash, neurofibromatosis.
Yeah, you have to ask about the blood pressure. Yeah, that's right. Especially in the examination. Okay.
Yes.
I think that's it. This was a case of phaeochromocytoma. Patient with multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2. He's presenting with palpitation. And if you ask the patient, he will tell you that I have an abdominal pain and I have a constipation. And if you ask him, if you examine him, you will find the neck swelling. He's not aware about the neck swelling, but if you examine the patient, you will find the neck swelling. I told you there's a neck swelling.
Yes.
In the drug history, in the drug history, I told you that this patient is taking salbutamol just to let you, to distract you with the salbutamol from your main diagnosis, okay? So most probably this is a case of multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, and the cause of palpitation most probably it would be a phaeochromocytoma, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hassan.
Thank you, Dr.
I'm going to talk about the case now by details, I fill the gaps and I will tell you more about the phaeochromocytoma, multiple endocrine neoplasia, and the thyrotoxicosis. So let's start from the beginning. This is a guy who is 29 years old. By the way, he is married and he had a two years old kid. Okay. So why I'm saying that? Because part of the management, if you have a multiple endocrine neoplasia, you have to talk about the genetic counseling and you have to talk about the screening for the first degree relative if the condition was diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia. So let's start from the beginning. Mr. Mike Ashley is 29 years old, presented with a palpitation. And he is married, he had a 2-year-old kid. Okay, so what when I tell you this patient has a palpitation, what is the approach for palpitation? What are the differential for palpitation that's important for us at the basis wise? Can someone tell me? What are
I have, yeah. I have put a cardiac causes like Hockham.
Okay.
I have put respiratory causes like pulmonary embolus. And pharmacological causes like any medications or caffeine.
Okay.
And of course, asking about fever and endocrinological like phaeochromocytoma or thyroid. And lastly, anxiety.
Okay, let's take them one by one. And let's try to try to find just some screening question that will help us to figure out what exactly the cause of palpitation in this patient. Okay, let's first of all, you have to analyze the palpitation. Can you analyze the palpitation in a way that will help you to get the diagnosis, the right diagnosis? I mean, if there's any specific question regarding to the palpitation can help you about the most probable diagnosis and will give you a clue toward the most probable diagnosis. If anyone can answer me, it's fine.
Tachycardia, bradycardia.
Okay, bradycardia. Okay, bradycardia. What it will tell you?
Tachycardia or bradycardia. We can differentiate between tachyarrhythmia and bradyarrhythmia.
Okay. No, I'm talking about the question. Let's now ask the patient, start analyzing the palpitation. What is the question that you are going to ask the patient? One of the questions that Dr. Hassan asked me was, is it regular or irregular? And he knocked the table by his finger, which is the right way to explain it to the patient. And that was a nice action from his side. So what are the questions that we use it when we analyze the palpitation?
Is persistent or intermittent?
Persistent or intermittent. Okay, what that will indicate to? What that will mean? If it is persistent, what does it mean? What
paroxysmal. Paroxysmal tachycardia.
How it starts and how it.
Okay, one by one. Just quickly, guys, because we want to move in the case quickly.
I can ask if it was accompanied by syncope.
Yeah, this is one of the very important questions, but we have to leave it at the end. Before you ask if it associated with syncope, you have to analyze the palpitation by itself. But syncope is a very important question, and I'm going to tell you why. Okay, before the syncope, what are you going to ask the patient?
Regular or irregular, fast or slow? Fast or slow?
Okay, fast or slow, regular or irregular, intermittent or persistent.
How frequent?
How it start and how it disappear?
Yes. And when exactly was the first time you noticed this palpitation? This is a very important question because it's usually will direct us toward the age of onset at which the patient developed this palpitation. This is very important because it's going to differentiate for you the list, the most probable cause of palpitation, whether it is something acquired or it is something hereditary or congenital. Okay, this is very important. You have to ask. So let's start from the beginning one by one. Let's organize ourselves. I'm going to ask the patient, when was the first time you noticed this palpitation? This is a very important question. Okay, if he told you it is just a three months back, most probably it's something acquired rather than something hereditary. Then we're going to ask the patient, did it happen suddenly or gradually? Most of the palpitation happens suddenly. Most of them. If it happened gradually and end gradually, this suggests this patient may have a sinus tachycardia. Okay. And then we're going to ask the patient for how long it lasts. If it is last just for a few seconds, most probably this is a premature ectopy. Premature ectopy, like premature atrial contraction, premature ventricular contraction. Okay. Then we're going to ask the patient, is it regular or irregular? Regular or irregular, you have to note it for, is it fast or slow? This is the first question, fast or slow. Then regular or irregular? Regular or irregular is going to differentiate for you most probably at the exam. And the most important thing is the atrial fibrillation, because atrial fibrillation is irregular. There are other irregular arrhythmia, but in the exam or from the history, it's very difficult to diagnose them. Just put in your mind, if he told you it is fast and irregular, most probably this is an atrial fibrillation. Then from the question that we also need, we need to ask the patient, is it associated with syncope or not? Why? Because if the patient develops syncope, this is imply that something dangerous is happening. Most probably this patient has ventricular tachycardia. And if the patient was young and he developed ventricular tachycardia, and the age of onset of palpitation was an aerial age, I would think about, for example, Hookham. Okay. Hookham is associated with ventricular tachycardia. Long QT interval syndrome can lead to torsadility point, which can lead to ventricular tachycardia. torsade point can lead to ventricular tachycardia. So if it's associated with syncope, you usually think about ventricular tachycardia. Okay. Near syncope or almost the patient going to black out, or the patient is nearly going to collapse, this is suggest the patient may have an atrial fibrillation or sometime an atrial flutter. Okay, so syncope is very important. Remember, those questions are not specific. Sometimes the patient may collapse, but it could not be because of ventricular tachycardia. Okay, sometimes the duration of palpitations will be a few seconds. It could be just, for example, something we call it one type of this non-sustained ventricular tachycardia. Non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, for example, it is last less than 30 seconds. So those questions, what I'm trying to say here, they are not specific. I told you if the duration was prolonged, think about something like atrial fibrillation, atrial tachycardia, but it is not going to be something a premature atrial contraction or premature ventricular contraction. But sometimes even ventricular tachycardia could last just for a few seconds. We call it non-sustained ventricular tachycardia. It lasts for less than 30 seconds. At the end, what I'm trying to say is you have to ask all of the questions and don't depend much on them at the basis exam. If you have to ask all the questions, when was the first time, the age at which he noted the symptoms, is it the duration of palpitation, what exactly he was doing before this palpitation happened, for how long it lasts, and how this palpitation terminated, and if there was associated syncope or not. Don't read too much into the answer of the patient, because in the exam, most probably the candidate will not be trained in a proper way to answer the question in a scientific way. But what I'm trying to say, ask all those questions. Remember to ask all of them. Don't forget one of them, okay? So this is the analysis of the palpitation. Now let's come to the differential diagnosis of the palpitation. What are the causes of palpitation basis-wise? Usually there are six, only six, okay? Either an issue with the heart, and we're gonna talk about the heart later on by details, or it could be pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary embolism, an issue within the lung, either pulmonary embolism or COPD. COPD unlikely in the exam to bring it for you presenting with palpitation, but remember COPD can cause multifocal atrial tachycardia, which can cause palpitation, but the most important condition in the lung that can cause palpitation is pulmonary embolism. So number one, the heart. Number two, pulmonary embolism. Number three, endocrine cause, and this is usually your target at the exam. In the exam, you have to rule mainly two things, either the heart issue and the endocrine issue. This is basis-wise I'm talking, okay? Endocrine issue, what are the common endocrine issue that appear at station five and cause palpitation? Usually two out of all the endocrine issue. Number one, thyrotoxicosis, and number two, pheochromocytoma, okay? Either thyrotoxicosis or pheochromocytoma. If there is any other endocrine issue that can cause palpitation, yes. For example, any cause of hypoglycemia can cause palpitation. Any cause of hypokalemia like Cushing's syndrome, Cone's syndromes, all of them can cause also palpitation. But remember, basis-wise, it is either pheochromocytoma or thyrotoxicosis, okay? The third cause, it could be a medication like theophylline or, for example, beta-2 agonist. Those are the two common scenarios that appear in the basis. Beta-2 agonist like salbutamol, formitrol, salmitrol, those are the commonest cause of palpitation basis-wise in addition to theophylline, okay? The other causes of palpitation in the exam, it could be caffeine and excessive smoking, excessive alcohol intake, all those can lead to palpitation. And the last cause is the high output conditions similar to anemia, pregnancy, fever, or Paget disease. Paget disease is not common in the exam, but it can appear. Usually they will give you a clue like high alkaline phosphatase and normal calcium. a normal phosphate before you go into the station, or sometimes you may find advanced case of Paget disease patient presented with frontal pulsing, sometimes even hearing loss, sometimes fracture and pulling of the tibia. But those are not common in the cases. Just put them in your mind. The most important causes of palpitation in the exam cases wise are either endocrine cause and the cardiological cause. Now let's go back to the cardiological cause of palpitation. You have to usually categorize them into two categories, whether it is something hereditary or something congenital, or it is something acquired. This is the first question. When the patient developed the palpitation was at younger age, or when he developed the palpitation, it was an old age, okay? This is the first question to determine whether it is acquired or it is congenital. And we have to know also the age of the onset of palpitation. And the third question is we have to ask about family history of cardiological disease. Those are the three things that will help you to differentiate between the acquired cause and congenital cause of palpitation. Then after we divide them into acquired and congenital, even the acquired itself is divided into two other subcategories, and the congenital also divided into another two subcategories. What are those subcategories? It could be structural cause, or it could be electrical issue. I mean, abnormality with the conduction pathway. What I'm trying to say, I'm going to give you an example so the things will not look hazy and look confusing for you. So let's say we're gonna talk about the acquired cause, okay? Let's say that the age of the patient was an old age, okay? And the age of the onset of palpitation was recently, and there is no family history of cardiological condition. This is most probably could be an acquired cause. Then in the acquired, we have either structural cause, something abnormal structure within the heart, or it could be abnormality with the conduction pathway. Abnormality within the structure, it could be something like an MI, a valve lesion like mitral regurg, mitral stenosis, mitral valve prolapse, aortic regurg, mechanical prosthetic valve, failure of pacemaker. Okay, those are most probably the cause of structure acquired cause of palpitation. If it is acquired and non-structural cause, I mean abnormality with the conduction pathway, it could be some sort of arrhythmia like atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, ventricular tachycardia, okay? This is most probably an acquired cause. Acquired non-structural cause of palpitation. Let's say in the exam, the age of the patient was a young age. The patient was 25, 26, early 30s. And let's say that this patient will tell you that I have this palpitation for a long time now. And the patient give you a clue toward a positive family history. In this scenario, you have to think about something familial or something hereditary. Even the hereditary and familial, we divided them into two categories, either something within the structure of the heart, like Hookham, ASD, VSD, bicuspid aortic valve, tetralogy of Fallot, okay? Or arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, okay? Or it could be something hereditary, but there is abnormality just with the conduction pathway, similar to Brugada syndrome, long QT interval syndrome. This is very common scenario at the exam, and we took a lot of example in our previous session, and we talk a lot about the long QT interval syndrome, congenital long QT interval syndrome, Brugada syndrome. Those are very common scenario that can appear at the exam, okay? So again, just to summarize, you have to ask the patient, you have to focus, if you think that this condition most probably it will be in the heart, try to figure out, is it something acquired or it is something congenital? How can I know that? Although those are not a specific question, but it will guide me. try to know for the duration of the palpitation, try to focus at the age of the patient, and try to ask about the family history. This will help you to differentiate between the acquired and between the congenital, okay? So those are the list of differential for the palpitation, okay? Then let's go on. So now we analyze the palpitation and we put a list of differential for palpitation. Now let's talk about the pheochromocytoma, okay? Let's talk about specifically about our patient. So our patient presented with a palpitation. In the history, we discovered that he had a constipation and he had an abdominal pain. Those are symptoms suggestive of hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia, usually in the exam, the patient will tell you I have either polyuria, polydipsia, constipation, abdominal pain, history of renal stone, and sometimes depression and abscess. Okay? In addition to that, the patient may have a neck swelling. Neck swelling, usually in the exam, if it's associated with pheochromocytoma, it suggests that this patient has medullary thyroid cancer, and you have to ask the patient about the loss of weight and loss of appetite to exclude or to be sure this is a medullary thyroid cancer. And in examination of the neck, you have to examine the lymph node, okay? So one of the most confusing part in the exam is how to differentiate between the pheochromocytoma and how we differentiate between the pheochromocytoma and thyrotoxicosis. I prepared just a simple slide. I hope it is going to be helpful for you, how we can differentiate in the exam between thyrotoxicosis and pheochromocytoma. Because usually in the exam, if your case, someone who is presenting with a tremor, someone who is presenting with excessive sweating, someone who is presenting with palpitation, those are at the top of your differential diagnosis. But how we can differentiate them? I put a list of, let me share with you this slide. I hope it's going to be helpful for you. Okay, can you see this picture? Hello, can someone answer me?
Yes.
Yes, doctor.
Okay, so this is just a comparison between symptom-wise, comparison between the thyrotoxicosis and pheochromocytoma. As we can see, both of them can cause palpitation. Both of them can cause excessive sweating. Both of them can cause tremor. Both of them can cause weight loss, although weight loss is more apparent with the thyrotoxicosis case. Both of them can cause neck swelling. Neck swelling with thyrotoxicosis, because of most probably this is just a goiter, okay? In few, it will be a hyperthyroid goiter. In the pheochromocytoma, usually it is medullary thyroid cancer, hyperplasia in the C cells, or sometime a cancer within the C cell. And we're gonna talk about that later on. But remember, if a patient with pheochromocytoma had a goiter, this is suggest that this patient has multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2. Thyrotoxicosis can cause hypertension. Pheochromocytoma can cause hypertension or can cause orthostatic hypotension, okay? So it can cause hypertension or orthostatic hypotension. Both of them can cause nervousness. Both of them can cause diarrhea. But if the patient with pheochromocytoma, if told you that I have a constipation, think about MEN type 2, okay? Then we come to the appetite. Thyrotoxicosis usually increases appetite, but pheochromocytoma patient usually they have a normal appetite. Thyrotoxicosis patient, if it was a female, our patient here was a male. We have to ask about the period. Usually in thyrotoxicosis, there is oligomenorrhea, but in pheochromocytoma, usually there is a normal period. The patient with thyrotoxicosis, usually they have a heat intolerance. On the opposite side, the patient with pheochromocytoma, they have episodic headache from time to time. The thyrotoxicosis patient, if it was a Graves disease, usually they have an eye symptoms. The irritation, the eye swelling, the conjunctival congestion. The pheochromocytoma patient, usually they have a dizziness. Why they have a dizziness? Usually because of the orthostatic hypotension. He will tell you, I have a dizziness when I change my position from sitting to standing, okay? Thyrotoxicosis patient, they may have a gynecomastia, and pheochromocytoma patient may have a hyperglycemia, okay? And there are many cases in the exam, patient with pheochromocytoma and they have glucose urea, or they have high blood sugar. So you have to think about pheochromocytoma if you get a patient with a tremor palpitation in addition to hyperglycemia. Okay. Is it clear, this picture? Do you have any question about this picture?
Doctor, why cytoma can cause neck mass?
Yeah, if it was pheochromocytoma, if it came alone, usually it doesn't cause goiter. But if there was a goiter, you have to think about multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, the patient we have medullary thyroid cancer associated with pheochromocytoma, and the condition will be, the final diagnosis will be pheochromocytoma associated with medullary thyroid cancer. So most probably this patient has MEN type 2.
Okay, doctor, thank you.
Okay. Any question regarding this picture?
Doctor Ala, both of them cause many symptoms the same, and the time in station 5 is very short.
Yeah, so
and the thyrotoxicosis does not have all the, so it need time to differentiate this is pheochromocytoma or
thyrotoxicosis. Yeah, so my very nice question, doctor. So my suggestion for you, ask about the headache and ask about the weather preference. Pheochromocytoma will never tell you that they have a weather preference. And thyrotoxicosis is unlikely to tell you I have a headache. Okay. Ask about the weather preference, ask about the headache, and if the patient is female, ask about the period. Okay. I think those are the, and ask about the appetite, of course. Okay. So I think those four questions can help you to differentiate between both of them. Okay. The appetite, the period, the weather preference, and the headache. Okay, I brought this scenario today because I know there are a lot of scenario where pheochromocytoma could be your diagnosis and you will go to thyrotoxicosis, and your final diagnosis could be a thyrotoxicosis and you will say this is a pheochromocytoma. It's very confusing for most of us, even for me when I was a PACES candidate. So I prepared this slide specifically. I hope it's going to help you. Just remember to ask about the heat intolerance or weather preference in addition to headache, in addition to period, in addition to the appetite. This is going to help you to differentiate between both of them. Okay. Sometimes when you step inside, they will tell you this patient has a palpitation. When you go inside, you will notice the clear, the Graves eye symptoms. So no need to think about pheochromocytoma at that time. Pheochromocytoma will never cause for you an eye symptoms. Okay. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yes, yes, doctor.
Okay. Okay, so those are the symptoms of, and this is from the history, how we can differentiate, or from the just analysis of the symptom and systemic review, how we can differentiate between the thyrotoxicosis and pheochromocytoma. And I can confirm to you in the exam, if you got a palpitation, most probably it could be one of those two conditions, most probably. Or if it is not one of those, it could be a cardiological cause. Cardiological cause, there are many scenarios came in the exam, and I think we have talked about that in our previous session. It could be Hockham. It could be a long QT interval syndrome. It could be other condition, but most probably those are the two most common condition. Long QT interval syndrome and Hockham, especially if they are acquired, because long QT interval syndrome could be congenital and could be acquired. Usually they will give you a clue from the family history, and the patient always is a young patient, okay? In long QT interval syndrome, you will notice that this patient started recently a new medication. It could be an antibiotic, could be antipsychotic, but there is a new medication that the patient just started. And because of the recent introduction of the new medication, he developed the long QT interval syndrome. The second possibility for long QT interval syndrome, this patient has some sort of electrolyte disturbance. Usually it is hypokalemia. You will notice in the exam that this patient has, he will tell you, I have a diarrhea. Then after a while, I start to develop the palpitation. So most probably the diarrhea led to hypokalemia, and the hypokalemia led to led to the palpitation and long QT interval syndrome. Okay, so this is a long QT interval syndrome. Who come? There is no specific question for who come from the history, but as I told you, always remember, if you have a palpitation, try to analyze the palpitation in a way that will help you to distinguish if it is something congenital or it is something acquired. Okay.
Doctor, regarding who come, I think if I asked about sudden cardiac death in the family.
Yeah, family history. As I told you, family yes. history about cardiological issue. Family history about cardiological issue. He will give you a strong clue. And this is something not specific for who come, by the way. All the congenital or hereditary congenital or all the hereditary or congenital cardiological condition in the exam, the patient will give you a clue from the family history. It could be Brugada syndrome. It could be arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. It could be long QT interval syndrome. It could be Hooker. Okay. So he will give you a clue from the family history. If he told you I have a family history of cardiac death, family history of some sort of heart disease, think about the cardiological issue. Don't think about thyrotoxicosis. Don't think about the about pheochromocytoma, because this is very strong clue. We can't just exclude it. We can't just ignore it. Sorry. We can't just ignore it. Okay. So again, just to emphasize one clear point, palpitation in the exam, it could be either cardiological issue or it could be endocrine issue. If it is endocrine issue, it could be thyrotoxicosis or it could be pheochromocytoma. Again, there are other causes of palpitation, but they are not common in the cases. You keep them in your mind. Remember that there are six causes of palpitation in general. In the exam, most probably, it could be one of those three conditions. Okay, don't forget Bagatelle disease, don't forget hypoglycemia, don't forget the pulmonary embolism, don't forget to ask the patient about the daily habits and the routine intake of the caffeine, don't forget to ask about the intake of alcohol. All those can be a contributing factor, or they could be the cause of palpitation, but they are not common in the exam. And ask about also the stress in his life, because panic attack, excessive stress, all those can cause palpitation. Okay.
Doctor, what do you think about illicit drugs? Is it illicit a cause drugs, of palpitation?
Yeah. Illicit drug, cocaine, amphetamine. I said before in one of our previous sessions, if your condition was hypertension in the exam, or if it was palpitation, or it was, there's a third symptom, I can't recall it right now, or chest pain. Remember, chest pain, hypertension, palpitation, always ask the patient about the recreational drug. Amphetamine and cocaine, they are very common cause of those three things. Okay, in addition to anabolic, there was a scenario before about anabolic steroid causing hypertension. So if your case in the exam was hypertension, chest pain, palpitation, remember to ask about recreational drug specifically. Okay, ask the patient. I'm sorry to ask you the next question, but it's a routine question. I ask it for all of my patient. Are you taking any recreational drug? Okay. So this is from the history. This is from the history, the analysis of the symptom, how we can differentiate between the previous condition. Now let's talk just more about pheochromocytoma. Let's go back to the examination of pheochromocytoma. I'm not going to talk about the examination of thyrotoxicosis or cardiological condition for sake of time, but I'm going to talk just more about pheochromocytoma because it was our patient today. So this is the examination for patient presenting with pheochromocytoma. Okay. If your case was a pure pheochromocytoma, we're gonna look at two things, okay? So let's just start from the vital sign. They can have hypertension, they can have orthostatic hypotension. Orthostatic hypotension, it is something very difficult to do it at the exam, but just tell the examiner, I would like to check the blood pressure while the patient is sitting, while the patient is standing. It's even when the patient is stand, you have to measure the blood pressure every minute for 5 minutes. And this is something non-applicable at the basis exam, but just tell the examiner, I would like to check the blood pressure while the patient is sitting and while the patient is standing to exclude the orthostatic hypotension. Okay? And in the pulse, we have to look for the tachycardia. Then, the next part of examination of pheochromocytoma, we have to look at the skin. Usually, the patient with pheochromocytoma, they are pale, not pallor of the conjunctiva. They are very pale. Their skin is, if they have a faint skin, usually you will notice that they have a pallor, especially during the attack of, headache, attack of the palpitation, the sweating, during the excessive secretion or the episodic secretion of the catecholamine, the patient looks pale. Why they look pale? Because of the vasoconstriction that's happening and affecting all the blood vessels during the episodic secretion of catecholamine. The patient will look pale, okay? There is one important thing that could be associated with pheochromocytoma, but it is not applicable to our case. Sometimes you may get a case of neurofibromatosis and it associated with pheochromocytoma. Remember the causes of hypertension in a patient with neurofibromatosis? It could be essential hypertension, it could be renal artery stenosis, it could be pheochromocytoma, or it could be coarctation of aorta. So we have to look quickly for the neurofibromatosis feature. You can ask the patient if you have any skin, if he has any skin change to exclude the caffeolate spots neurofibroma. Ask the patient to raise his arm up to check the axilla. And there is the one thing that I don't want you to focus don't focus or give it too much attention. It's lichen amyloidosis. It's a one of associated condition that also that could present with that could accompany the main type 2 lichen amyloidosis or cutaneous amyloidosis. To make it easier for you, the patient usually have hyperpigmentation in some part of his body. This could be associated with main type 2A. Then we have to look at the neck, looking for goiter and cervical lymphadenopathy. If they are present, this suggests that the patient has a medullary thyroid cancer and the patient has a main type 2. We have to look at the tongue if the patient has mucosal neuroma. Mucosal neuroma, it's a part of main type 2B. Just ask the patient to protrude his tongue. You will notice clear swelling at his tongue, clear neuroma at his tongue. This suggests that the patient has main type 2B. Then we have to examine the abdomen, looking for any abdominal mass. Musculoskeletal marfanoid habitus, this is usually common with main type 2B. Main type 2B, the patient have marfanoid habitus, the long, tall arms and long, tall legs. And some patient may have even the scoliosis, rectus craniatum, and other symptoms of the other signs, sorry, of the Marfan. So, quickly, if you would like to examine the patient with a pheochromocytoma, you have to just focus on those few things. It is unlikely in the exam to get a very complicated case, a case with neurofibromatosis and pheochromocytoma, although it's appeared in the exam, but it's appeared in Egypt in one of the exams, I think in 2019, early 2019, there was a case of pheochromocytoma and neurofibromatosis. But lichen amyloidosis, mucosal neuroma, marfanoid habitus, main type 2B, it is unlikely to appear in the exam, but just keep it in your mind, keep this slide with you. So in case if you encountered such a case in the exam, you will not be surprised and you will be able to handle the case in a proper way. Okay, so this is the examination of the, of the patient with pheochromocytoma. Remember, because this patient has a palpitation, we have to examine the cardiovascular system properly. I have to palpate the apex. I have to check for the left parasternal heave. I have to palpate the second heart sound. I have to examine the, I have to auscultate all the heart sound in a proper way. Okay. Patient may have an atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation is very common with mitral valve lesion. The patient may have a mitral stenosis. The patient may have a mitral regurg. And those patients, it is fatal if you could not able to detect the murmur at the exam. The only finding in the exam, it could be just the murmur. It could not be a few chromosomes. I'm not talking about few chromosomal case. I'm talking if your case in the exam was a pure palpitation. Palpitation, you couldn't detect anything in the history. So most probably all your finding will be on the examination. I know station five is very stressful, but if your case was a blank case, a case that there is nothing positive from the history, most probably you will get the diagnosis from the examination. So if my case in the exam, it was palpitation and I was keep asking the patient all the routine and regular question, he keep telling me, no, 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 nothing was positive. I will focus on the examination and I will do the examination, cardiovascular examination in a proper way. Because as I told you, most probably this patient may have a valvular lesion that could be the reason behind the palpitation. And I have to figure out which murmur he had so I will be able to know the final diagnosis. Okay, so this is the examination. After the examination, the patient will tell you, what do I have, doctor? How we can explain pheochromocytoma and multiple endocrine neoplasia to the patient? Can someone explain it for me? Anyone of you? Can someone explain for me in a proper way, or just try your best? How you can explain multiple endocrine neoplasia to the patient?
This is a hereditary disease which runs in the families through a specific genes.
Hereditary. You can say hereditary.
Yeah.
Try again. Let's start from the beginning. What you will say?
It's a familial disease.
Okay.
It runs in the families.
Okay.
Yeah, which affects certain organs in the body, like neck, like kidneys, and other organs as well.
Okay, so just can you repeat it again from the beginning?
Yeah, it is a familial condition which runs in the families through a specific genes, and it can affect neck, kidneys, and brain, and certain other organs in the body.
Okay. Yeah. So is it a cancer or not?
Yeah, it is cancer. It is, yeah. But main type 1 and main type 2 has cancer, medullary thyroid cancer.
Okay. Yeah. As Dr. Khan said, you will tell the patient, I'm sorry to tell you this is, or you can tell him you have a familial condition that running the family through a specific codes or gene. It's a rare disease. It's usually, in this condition, usually there is an overgrowth or there is a tumor. You can say tumor, by the way, in the exam. Tumor is not a jargon. You can tell the patient, either you can choose whatever you think it's right for you, but I'm telling you, and I can assure you, a tumor is not a jargon. You can tell the, but just if you want to avoid it, avoid any hassle at the exam, you can just tell the patient it is just an overgrowth. It's a familial condition that run in the family through specific codes or gene that lead to overgrowth in multiple organ or multiple glands within your body. One of those affected glands, it's a gland located at the front side of your neck or the lateral side of your neck, and glands located also above your kidney, and a gland located in the front and the lateral side of your neck, and the gland located above your kidney, lead to overproduction or over secretion or over what you can tell, overactivity of those glands, and will lead to secretion of excessive hormones that will lead to the symptom that you have. I'm sorry to tell you, one of those overgrowth is a cancer. Okay? So let's repeat it from the beginning. It's a familial condition running the family through specific code or genes lead to overgrowth affecting multiple glands in your body, affect the glands in the front and the lateral side of your neck and the gland that is located above your kidney, lead to production of excessive amount of hormones that will lead to the symptom that you have. And I'm sorry to tell you, one of those overgrowths or one of those gland most probably is affected by a cancer, or most of one of those glands already had a cancer within them. Okay, you have to tell him that he had a cancer. You have to tell the patient that he had a cancer. Okay, if the patient asks you the next concern, who is going to ask that? Who going to answer the next concern? If I ask you and I tell you, is it a cancer, doctor? You have to tell me, I'm sorry to tell you, yes, one of those glands had a cancer within it, cancerous cell or cancer cells within it. Okay, if I told you, can it affect my children? I told you in the beginning of the history, I have a 2 years old child. Will it affect my child? Will it affect my kid?
Yes, this is a sort of disease which runs in the family, and there are 50% chances of every time you get the baby, there are 50% chance that he may get this disease.
Okay, that's good. Okay, that's good. If he told you, how can I know if my baby had this condition, what you will tell him? If my child had this condition or not, what you will tell him?
The only way to know is there is some special testing called genetic testing, where we test the genes or code responsible for this disease.
Yes, we have to. I'm going to refer you to a genetic counselor. He is going to offer you a specific test or a special test. We call it test. 1 minute, guys. Yes. Okay, so we're going to refer you to a genetic counselor. He's a specialist on doing those tests. He's going to explain for you the benefit and the risk of those tests, of having this test. Usually by having those tests, we will be able to detect the faulty gene or the faulty codes that can lead to the disease, can lead to this disease. Okay, so this is how we can answer him. Okay. This is the concern. Most probably, okay, he will tell you what kind. Is it because of the coffee that they have? Is it because of the coffee and the stress that they have this palpitation? What you will tell him?
This coffee and tea can aggravate your condition.
Yes, yes.
They are not the basic reason for that.
Yeah. So you have to tell him that although the coffee and the stress that you are having in your life can contribute or can aggravate the symptom that you have, aggravate the palpitation that you have, but I'm sorry to tell you, it is unlikely to be the main reason behind your palpitation. Okay. So I think those are the main concern will be in the exam. If he tell you, how can I prevent this condition from being transmitted to my next baby, for example, if I want to have another baby and I'm afraid that my next baby will have this condition, if there is any way to avoid such a fate?
Unfortunately, there is no way to prevent this condition.
Oh boy. No. No, this is not the right answer, Dr. Khan. You killed the patient. You closed all the door and shut it all in front of me.
Is there any way to prevent this condition?
Yes, there are. We can prevent this by when your wife get pregnant, and we can. There are specific measures where there are tests we can. We are saying their name is this. Chorionic villus sampling, and there are some specific tests we can do on the womb to check whether they are.
Those are for diagnosis only.
You are confused. Okay, just let me clear it. Dr. Hamad.
Yes.
the before she got pregnant, not after she got pregnant. If she got pregnant, the chorionic villus sampling and amniotic fluid sampling, this is for the diagnosis of the current, if the baby has currently has this condition. But if I want to prevent the condition before it is spread to the baby or before it transmitted to the baby, we have to do in vitro fertilization. So you're gonna explain it for the patient in the following way. You will tell him, yes, there is a way. We can extract the sperm from you and the egg from your wife, and we can mix them together or combine them together in a laboratory dish or in the lab, combine them together artificially in the lab. Then when the egg start to grow, then we're gonna take that eggs, examine them and check which one of them is healthy one. If the healthy one, then we're gonna take it back to the womb of your wife, okay? By this way, we will be sure that your next baby will not have will have this condition. This is something we call it in vitro fertilization. I'm going to refer you to the woman doctor. She will be at fertilization clinic where they will be able to give you more information and more details about this procedure in case you need it in the future. Okay.
So doctor, you mean all these hereditary conditions, familial condition could be prevented?
Yeah, could be prevented if you know the gene, because men type 2, there is specific gene. It's red germline gene. Yeah, if you know the gene, you can avoid the condition.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, if you know the gene, the issue is there some condition, either there is no specific gene or determined gene yet, and there are some condition, there are multiple genes that contributing to the condition. So those two type of condition where you can't prevent them. Anyway, we are not going to discuss that by details. What you're going to explain to the patient, yeah, there is a way. I'm going to refer you to a genetic counselor. By the way, all those details, you have to tell the patient that I'm going to refer you to a genetic counselor. He's going to explain for you the benefit and the risk of having the genetic test, the potential result, the impact, and what those results mean, and what is the option that you will have in case in the future you didn't want to have a baby with such a disease. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Your answer, Dr. Khan, the amniotic fluid sampling and Dr. Hamad, your answer about taking a sample from the chorionic, from the fluid surrounding the baby. This is the answer if the mother was pregnant. There's a scenario about myotonic dystrophy. A mother who is pregnant, a lady who is pregnant, and she wants to know if her, if the baby will be born with this condition or not. That's a different story. We have to take a sample from the fluid surrounding the baby or from one of the organ inside or from one of the tissue that is feeding your baby. We call it the placenta. We're gonna take a sample from that organ. And we're going to examine it in the lab, and then we're going to determine, and we will know if your baby has that condition or not. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. What are the other concerns that the patient with multiple endocrine? What is the treatment, doctor? How are you going to treat me, doctor? If he asks you that question, what you will tell him?
This is a multidisciplinary team approach involving multiple specialist doctors.
Okay, will I need a surgery, doctor?
Yeah, the surgeon will decide either you needed the surgery or not. We will refer you to a multidisciplinary.
Don't be hesitant in the exam. If the patient have a multiple endocrine neoplasia, you have to tell him that I'm sorry to tell you that the only treatment to your condition is the surgical resection of those affected organs. Don't be hesitant. If you are hesitant, and you keep telling the patient that I'm going to refer you, it need to be discussed. The case is straightforward, multiple endocrine neoplasia. The only treatment is the surgical resection. There is no other way. Okay. So don't be hesitant in the exam. If the treatment is straightforward, this is one of the concerns the patient had. He wants to know if he will have a surgery or not. So you can't tell him just, I will ask, I will see, I will refer. Ah, this is not accepted at the exam. They will deduct your mark at the concert. Okay?
The surgery also for pheochromocytoma for the
for all of them. For all of them. All of them have to be surgically resected. We're going to speak about the treatment just after a while. Okay, so now we finish the concern. Let's go to the diagnosis. How we diagnose multiple endocrine neoplasia?
These are diagnosed with the blood test and as well as with imaging.
I need to hear the voices of your other colleague. I need someone else to talk. Thank you, okay, Dr. Khan. Okay. You are very
thank you.
You are very motivated. Doctor, how we diagnose multiple endocrine neoplasia? How we diagnose multiple endocrine neoplasia? Type 2A, to be specific.
Check the RET gene.
Okay, before that, we're going to speak about that later on, but before that.
Biopsy from thyroid biopsy.
This is the wrong answer. This is also not the right answer. You are going from, you are taking me from back up to the front. I need the initial test. What are the initial tests if I would like to diagnose multiple endocrine neoplasia? Biopsy is not right. Gene test is not right. Before that,
Normetendefrin and metendefrin in 24 yes, urine.
Yes, doctor. Thank you, doctor. Dr. Hosni?
No.
Yes, Dr. Hosni, yeah. So we have three affected glands. We need to check the marker for those three glands. Just simply at that. Okay. So let's take them one by one. Remember that multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, it's a thyroid cancer. The most common gland that's affected in multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, it is medullary thyroid cancer. Whether it is type 2A or type 2B, it is medullary thyroid cancer. How we can screen the medullary thyroid cancer?
Calcitonin. Okay.
Yeah. So we need the serum calcitonin and we need the carcinoembryonic antigen. Okay. There is a usually C cell gland within the thyroid. Those glands secrete the calcitonin and secrete the carcinoembryonic antigen. So we need those two markers. Okay. For the medullary thyroid cancer, we need
CEA.
CEA. Yeah.
Again?
TA. CEA.
Carcinoembryonic what?
Globulin? Carcinoembryonic antigen.
CEA.
Calcitonin and carcinoembryonic antigen. Okay, this is for medullary thyroid cancer. If I want to screen for the hyperparathyroidism, what I'm going to do? What I'm going to request?
PTH.
Huh?
PTH.
Serum calcium is the number one. Number two, then we're gonna check the parathyroid hormone. Okay, for pheochromocytoma, what is the marker?
Metanephrine
in the blood and 24-hour urinary metanephrine. So we have a two marker for every one of those glands. Calcitonin and carcinoembryonic antigen for medullary thyroid cancer. We need the serum calcium, then parathyroid hormone for the hyperparathyroidism, and for pheochromocytoma, we need the serum metanephrine and urinary metanephrine, 24-hour urinary metanephrine. Then let's go to the biopsy. Which one of those glands I will do the biopsy, and which one of them before the biopsy? What next? What is the next test?
What is abdominal the next CT. Imaging.
Yes, imaging. What imaging? Yep. And for which gland?
CT for pheochromocytoma.
Yeah, CT for pheochromocytoma. And for the thyroid, what you will do?
MIBG scan.
No. Who said MIBG scan? MIBG scan, this is for pheochromocytoma and it has a clear indication. I'm not for every patient. I'm going to talk about that later on. But let's go back to the thyroid.
Dual or cold nodule? Yes.
Sorry?
Nodule or cold nodule?
Yeah, we need the
ultrasound. Nodule or cold?
We need simply ultrasound. Ultrasound, bedside ultrasound. Okay. Ultrasound for the thyroid. CT scan for the abdomen. For hyperparathyroidism, we don't need anything. Okay. We don't need any imaging scan. Just the serum calcium and parathyroid hormone. Okay. What next? Then after the imaging, what I'm going to do?
Biopsy of the thyroid.
Okay, just before we go to that, after the imaging, usually the imaging, before we go into the next step, after the image, usually we have two types of image for every gland, either anatomical image and functional imaging. Anatomical imaging, similar to the ultrasound and CT scan. Functional imaging, like for example, the thyroid scan, thyroid scintigraphy, and for the example, the MIBG scan, M-I-B-G-I scan, MIBG scan. Those scans have a clear indication, okay? They have an indication. We don't do them just routinely without a clear indication.
Clear indication.
Yeah. So scintigraphy, usually we do it in the patient if they have in the ultrasound, there was a nodule. So when you do the ultrasound for the patient and you notice they have a nodule or they have a multinodular goiter, okay, then we can go with the thyroid scan after the ultrasound. Okay, this is the thyroid scan for the patient with medullary thyroid cancer.
Yeah, the thyroid function test we will not do before that. If it is low TSH.
Yeah, we will do the thyroid function test, but I'm talking about the specific marker. We talk about the specific marker, then we talk about the specific imaging. We will do the ultrasound. After the ultrasound, we will do the thyroid scan or the scintigraphy if the patient has a nodule or multinodular goiter. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, now let's go to the pheochromocytoma. What are the imaging study? There is a functional imaging, which is the MIBG scan and the PET scan, the scintigraphy, MIBG scan, MIBG scan. We do that if the patient has a suspicion of metastatic disease. If we think that the pheochromocytoma is a cancer, it is not just a simple pheochromocytoma. It's a cancer, it was a bilateral, it was spreading, there is a lymph node enlargement. We thought that this pheochromocytoma is a cancer, then we need the MIBG scan. Or if the initial CT, it didn't confirm the diagnosis, the result was unequivocal. Okay, it was very small, the location was abnormal location. Those are the indications for doing the functional imaging like the MIBG scan or the PET scan, even PET scan, PET, PET scan can be done for the pheochromocytoma.
PET scan.
Okay. Okay, next. For multiple endocrine neoplasia, what we will do? So we finish the marker for all of them. We finish the image. What we will do next? I need to hear the voices of the other candidates, the people who are listening and they don't want to talk. What you will do next?
I think they slept.
Excisional biopsy.
What you will do?
Rule out metastasis from medullary thyroid carcinoma by do ultrasound abdomen and CT chest for liver.
Okay.
At the time of diagnosis, it is metastatic.
Ignore the metastasis. We are not going to talk about metastasis now. We are talking about every gland. The gland itself, we are not looking for the metastasis of the cancer, for medullary thyroid cancer metastasis. We are looking for the test specified to those glands. What else we will do?
We will do excision biopsy for this thyroid gland.
Okay, biopsy. Biopsy for which gland? Which gland we will do the biopsy and which gland we will avoid the biopsy? Who can answer this? Who can open the mic and tell me the answer for this question?
We will do a resection for the thyroid gland and the send for histopathology. Okay. If it comes with the thyroid cancer,
before that.
MIN2A.
Okay. Let me answer this question just for the sake of saving time. Biopsy, usually for medullary thyroid cancer, we need a biopsy. Okay, biopsy, it usually done as a routine for the patient with medullary thyroid cancer. We do the fine needle aspiration, okay?
It will not work. Fine needle biopsy will not work.
Fine needle biopsy. Fine needle biopsy. It is the initial diagnostic procedure for every thyroid medullary cancer, medullary thyroid cancer. Okay.
Okay.
And it is not the routine. It is not something routine that we should do it, but we can do it. Okay. So it is usually the biopsy of choice for the patient of medullary thyroid cancer. For primary hyperparathyroidism, usually biopsy is not recommended. It's not a contraindicated, but it's not recommended. Okay. Primary hyperparathyroidism, we don't do it. We don't do it as routine. And if the primary hyperparathyroidism, usually in primary hyperparathyroidism, what is the pathology? Is it a cancer? It is not a cancer. Usually either there is adenoma. Adenoma, yes, or hyperplasia. Okay. Yes. Either adenoma or hyperplasia. Okay. Either adenoma or hyperplasia. It is not usually recommended, except if the case was very difficult case and it is unusual case and the symptoms was and the marker, the screening were not conclusive. This is the only time we will do the biopsy for the patient with hyperparathyroidism. Okay, so again, for medullary thyroid cancer, we will do the fine needle aspiration, straightforward as an initial diagnostic test. For primary hyperparathyroidism, we don't do the biopsy as routine. We try to avoid them. We don't do them as routine. It is not going to add anything in your final diagnosis. It is usually indicated if the patient had unusual symptoms, unusual difficult case to diagnose, and the marker was not conclusive. Okay. And if we suspect that the primary hyperparathyroidism because of a cancer, biopsy will be contraindicated. Okay? If a parathyroid cancer is suspected, it is contraindicated the biopsy. For pheochromocytoma, the biopsy is absolutely contraindicated. No biopsy for pheochromocytoma. Why we avoid the biopsy in the patient with pheochromocytoma?
Can go in crisis.
The patient can develop very severe hypertension, okay, yes, which is very difficult to control. And the bleeding from pheochromocytoma is usually very heavy bleeding and it's very difficult to control. And it will make the surgical resection of the tumor very difficult. So biopsy usually is not, it is contraindicated. I can say absolutely contraindicated for the patient with pheochromocytoma. The diagnosis of pheochromocytoma either with the marker and plus or minus the imaging. We can do even an MRI. If CT scan was not conclusive, we can do an MRI, but we don't do biopsy for pheochromocytoma. Okay, this is the general rule. Okay.
Again, so Dr. Halak, sorry. Pheochromocytoma biopsy contraindicated because it will cause what? Hypertension and what else?
It will cause bleeding, hypertension, and it will make the further resection of the tumor very difficult.
Dr. Halak, please.
This session is recording, guys. So if you miss something, you can always come back and listen to it later on.
Dr. Alat, you said that the screening was not conclusive. Screening mean about the parathyroid? You mean to say that the parathyroid hormone and the serum calcitonin levels, there is some difficulty in finding that?
Yeah, if it was not conclusive, you can go for biopsy. Okay, so what is the treatment? Before that, The last thing in the diagnosis is the genetic test. Okay, so you will start with the blood test, then you will do the imaging, then you will go for biopsy, and we discuss the biopsy and which one of them need a biopsy. The last thing is the genetic test. What are the indication for you? Which are the patients we will do for them the genetic test? There is a clear criteria from the NHS website. I'm going to share it with you. This is the criteria for doing the genetic testing to the patient with suspect multiple endocrine neoplasia. Just let me share it with you. I don't know where I put it. Uh, Okay. You can take a screenshot for this picture. So this is the criteria, the testing criteria. When we test for genetic study, or when we offer a genetic study for a patient with multiple endocrine neoplasia. So as you can see, we usually offer the patient with the test for genetic test for the patient with suspected multiple endocrine neoplasia. If the patient, if the individual he has or he don't have a family history, and the broadband means this is the individual who is affected. He had a medullary thyroid cancer, or if he had two or more medullary multiple endocrine neoplasia related abnormality, or if he had one abnormality of multiple endocrine abnormality, and he had another family history, another first degree relative of multiple endocrine neoplasia related endocrine abnormality. Again, any patient with medullary thyroid cancer, he has to go for the genetic test. If you don't have a medullary thyroid cancer, but he had primary hyperparathyroidism, and he had, for example, pheochromocytoma, he had the both of them, he should go for the genetic test. If he had one of them, like primary hyperparathyroidism or pheochromocytoma, if he has one of them, in addition to that, he had a one family history, one of his first degree relative had another endocrine abnormality related to the multiple endocrine neoplasia, then the patient should go for genetic testing. I'm going to repeat them again. If you have medullary thyroid cancer, regardless whether you have pheochromocytoma or you have a primary hyperparathyroidism, you have to be referred to genetic counselor to have the genetic test. But let's say in the exam you had the case of pheochromocytoma and primary hyperparathyroidism. If he had the two, both of them, he has to go for the genetic study. Okay? If he had one of them and he had a various degree relative also who has one of them, then we can refer also the patient to the genetic study. Okay? Remember that Hirsch's brain disease, I told you in the scenario, when we was discussing the case and practicing the case, I told you when I was 1 month old, I had some sort of bowel surgery. That surgery was a corrective surgery for Hirsch's brain disease. Remember that Hirsch's brain disease is one of the associated condition with multiple endocrine neoplasia. Usually the patient with multiple endocrine neoplasia, they may have two other conditions. One of them is cutaneous amyloidosis, and the second one is Hirsch's brain disease. Okay, I don't need you to focus too much on those things. In the exam, if you got a case of multiple endocrine neoplasia, you are not going to get the Hirsch's brain disease and amyloidosis, but just we are mentioning them in case you encounter them. But during your study and during your practice, no need to focus on those small things. Okay. So this is the criteria for offering the genetic test to the patient who is suspected to have medullary thyroid cancer, or he has pheochromocytoma or primary hyperparathyroidism. Okay, so we discussed the concern, we discussed the diagnosis, we discussed the treatment. Okay, I'm going to offer the genetic test to the baby who is 2 years old. Yes or no?
Yes.
Why?
1 month. Because we can do prophylactic removal of thyroid gland.
Yes, you are right. So the criteria which I shared with you, those are the criteria for the patient who was diagnosed with medullary thyroid cancer or with pheochromocytoma or with primary hyperparathyroidism. The patient is diagnosed with the marker, with the imaging, plus or minus the biopsy. Now we want to know if we should offer him with the genetic test or not. Then we're going to check that list of the indication. But let's say I have one of my children, I have been diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia. What are the guidelines or what are the indication we use or what are the criteria we use to offer the test for the for our relatives or for the relative of the patient? What are those criteria? If there is any criteria, I tried to look in the net, but I found only one criteria from the American Thyroid Association. I'm going to share it with you. Just no need to recall it, no need to focus too much on it, but just maybe you can just take a look at it. Remember that we offer the genetic test, RET mutation, RET germline mutation, to a person with a heuristic. I'm going to highlight only the important things for us. Any patient with any person with a Ferris degree relative with proven hereditary medullary thyroid cancer. So if our patient, Mr. Mike Ashley, diagnosed at the end with medullary thyroid cancer, okay? Even if it was, even if the genetic test was negative, we have to offer his kid the genetic test, okay? If he was diagnosed with medullary thyroid, if he was diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia, then we have to, we have also to offer his family relative with a genetic test. I'm sorry if it looks confusing. I'm sorry if it is look not clear, but just remember, if you have a Ferris degree relative with multiple endocrine neoplasia, you have to do for the patient a genetic test, okay? So let's say that the baby was diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia. He is 2 years old, diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia. What I'm going to do for him?
Follow up.
Dissection of thyroid gland.
Yes. Serum calcitonin.
You offered for him. You offered for him the genetic study, and it came positive. He had a gene mutation for multiple endocrine neoplasia. What are you going to do for him? He's only 2 years old.
Prophylactic thyroidectomy.
Yeah, we do a prophylactic thyroidectomy at the age of 5 years old, even if the calcitonin level is not high. If the calcitonin level is high, we do the surgery at earlier time, even before 5 years old. You got it? Is it clear? So what we will do?
Can be calcitonin.
At what age we should offer this genetic testing?
At the time of
diagnosis.
Yeah, at the time of diagnosis of his parent. If your parent was diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia, you have a Ferris degree relative diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia, you have to offer the test for the baby at the time of diagnosis of his relative. So even if he's 2 years old, I'm going to offer him the test now. And I'm going to check if the test is positive. I have to do the prophylactic thyroidectomy at the age of 5 years. Okay, but if the calcitonin level was normal, but if the calcitonin level was high, we can do the surgery before the 5 years old. Okay.
Can be calcitonin high without lump in the thyroid?
Yeah, without the lump. You do it as prophylactic. If there is a lump, that is straightforward indication to take the gland out. Okay? Here we are talking
for pheochromocytoma.
For pheochromocytoma and hyperparathyroidism, you start the screening by the age of 11. Okay? You check the serum calcium in addition to the parathyroid hormone, in addition to the urinary metanephrine and plasma metanephrine at the age of 11. Okay, so the screening for hyperparathyroidism and pheochromocytoma, it start at slightly an older age. Okay. Yeah, one of your colleagues here, Dr. Assisi, he shared with me that according to the genetic risk. Yeah, you are right, doctor. I don't want to go into the details about how we stratify this patient. Usually we stratify the patient according to the exon and according to the codon site of the mutation. And according to that, we stratify the patient into the high risk, moderate risk, and low risk. Then according to the categorization, if the patient is high risk, we do the screening at different age. If the patient is at a moderate risk, we do at a different age. But as advice for me to you in the exam, those things are very, very specialized. This is not the scope of the basis that we need to spend a lot of time and a lot of effort on it. I try to avoid it as much as I can, but I just mentioning here because this session is going to be recorded. So if in case you want to return back and check this information, you are always welcome to find it here. But as you said, as one of your Dr. Sisi, he raised to me he sent a message in the chat, and he said according to the risk, yes, you are right. According to the codon-based genotype-phenotype correlation, this is the right way to stratify the patient, and then we are going to do the screening according to that. But those are very specialized details. No need to focus on them. Okay? Just remember, as a rule, we do the screening at the age of 5 and at the age of 11. I know if you are moderate risk, we are going to do it at different age. Usually, medullary thyroid cancer starts at the age of 5. But pheochromocytoma and hyperparathyroidism, we can start them at age of 16 if the patient has a moderate risk. Okay? But don't focus so much on that. Just remember, we're going to offer the genetic test for the relative of someone who was diagnosed with multiple endocrine neoplasia. If he's less than 5 years old, we're going to do the prophylactic thyroidectomy at the age of the 5, and we're going to screen the hyperparathyroidism and pheochromocytoma at the age of 11. If the markers came positive, we're going to do the surgery for both of them. Okay? Take it as a general guide rather than small details, because the more you know about it, the more you will feel it very difficult to recall it before the exam.
Dr. Ala, I have a question.
Yes, Dr. Hala.
Although it is not directly related to this our topic, but as regards this genetic testing here in communication, there is a situation where we have to do the testing definitely before the age of 18 or without getting the consent. Are there any other scenarios except this men that where we have to do the genetic testing? For the children?
Well, you do the genetic test if it is going to change the plan of management. If it's going to, like, for example, Huntington disease, there is no treatment. We are not going to offer the genetic test unless he's at an old age or he's mature enough to decide by himself. But if it is going to change the plan of management, you have to do it. Okay?
No, my question is that in children, we have to do, this is one of the examples you have
given. Yeah, this is one of the examples.
Is there any other examples in the PACES exam where we have to do the genetic testing in the early age without the consent?
I can't recall it right now, but just take it as a general rule. If it is going to change your plan of management, it's going to change something that fatal in a patient's life, yeah, you have to do it even if the patient is less than 18 years. Because there is no, I can't find for you a guideline or some website who is going to answer this question, because it's not a simple question. Okay, it's a very complicated question. You have to take it case by case, try to apply your common sense, and then I think you will be able to reach to the
most. I thought maybe you have in your notes this
no,
also.
No, there is nothing like that. No, you have to take it case by case. Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So this is multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2A. It's a very common scenario in the exam, especially the pheochromocytoma associated. One of the very common topic in the exam. Palpitation is also one of the very common topic in the exam. There are many causes of palpitation in the exam, like as I said before, long QT interval syndrome, Hookham, both of them can appear in station 5, both of them can appear in station 4. Multiple endocrine neoplasia appeared in the exam in different way. It appeared in station 4 before, it appeared in station 5, but this is the general rule. This is the common concern that can you can face in the exam. I don't think there is much to say about them. Don't dig too much into the details. Don't spend your time on focus. Don't waste your time on the thing that's not going to add any mark for you at the exam. Focus on the main things and the basic things. And as I said, always try to practice as much as you can. Try to practice as much as you can. In the exam, you will have a very limited time. You will be under a very stressful situation. You have to be on the automated mode. There is no time to thinking. You have to have a constant phrase, fixed phrase, how to explain the disease, how to answer the concern. Do things when you repeat them in your practice, many ways in the exam, you will find them very difficult, very easy to mention them. Okay, you will not find the difficulty to recall those things in the exam. Okay, focus on the examination. Most of the people fail the exam because they couldn't identify the physical finding, the positive physical finding. So please focus on the examination and focus on the basic. Focus on the basics. Don't waste your time. Don't spend too much time reading about the fancy stuff, the specialized stuff. Those things is not going to add any mark for you at the exam.
Dr. Allah, how we can differentiate between acquired and congenital long QT in our routine scenarios?
Yeah, okay. Well, as I told you, all the congenital heart disease, all the congenital cardiological disease, in the exam, they will give you a clue that this patient had these symptoms this symptom started at earlier age of his life. Those symptoms, he had those symptoms for a long time now. And most probably you will find a strong family history. Okay? There is no clear cut answer, but those are clues. Some clues will help you to know if it is something congenital or hereditary. Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, if there is no question, we're gonna stop here. Thank you everyone for listening to my long speech.
Thank you, Dr. Allah. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. I'm going to upload this session into the YouTube. You can watch it there anytime you want. Thank you, everyone. And please, if you have any specific topic you want me to talk about, if you want us to shift into another station, station 4, station 2, even station 1 and 3, I don't mind it. Just send for me in the WhatsApp, and I'm happy to practice that station with you. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Till we meet again soon, inshallah.